So, you and the big guy had a run-in recently, huh?
Yeah, how'd that go?
I mean, no, really, I want to know. And so does everyone else. Put down all the details in an email and send it to contact@buckeyebigfoot.com. I'll narrate your story, and then we can all hear about your meetup with the King of the Forest. Welcome back to Buckeye Bigfoot. Hey there. Hello, everyone. Well, you know, I strongly suggest that you have the snackage piled high on your plate and that your drink is filled right to the top for tonight's encounter. It's coming to us from a man named Rusty, and he has a lot to say about his granddad's long-lived relationship with a family of Sasquatch. Yes, Rusty himself got to interact with this family. So go on, settle into that comfy saddle, because we're going to hit the trail right away. We got a long way to go to catch up to that Sasquatch family living down in the valley. Let's go. Dear Nance, I hope this message finds you and yours well in all aspects of life. Thanks for providing this platform for us to tell our truths and testimonials with no judgment or ridicule. This means a lot to me. Someone whose own mother said I was weird, and she couldn't believe that I would lie and make up bull spit like this all about her daddy. I'll go by Rusty for this story. A little background about my family and I. I'm a city boy, born and raised in Detroit, Michigan, three doors down from my grandparents, who had moved to Detroit from North Carolina in the late 1940s, after my granddad's discharge from the Navy and serving in World War II. My granddad kept his family's land in North Carolina, close to the South Carolina border. Without getting too particular about the exact location, the closest town would be Green Creek, which is a very small town. The area is rocky, no really high peaks, but plenty of creeks and caves. Through the years, my granddad would visit his land frequently and also acquired any neighboring plots that he could. By the time I was born in 1980, he had over 300 acres, a small trailer, barn, and a metal shed where he kept his tractor, side-by-side, and three four-wheelers he had bought for me and my cousins to ride when we would go with him down south in the summers. Granddad was a country boy to the core. He enjoyed hunting, fishing, and this I learned later in life, making moonshine. I was born in the spring of 1980, 2 months earlier than expected, but also the same day that my granddad had his first surgery for prostate cancer, which he lived with for 22 years until he finally lost his battle. But he also officially retired from his construction job the spring of 1980. So, he and my grandma, being three doors away, well, they were naturally the only babysitters I ever knew, and both my parents worked full-time. My granddad told me whatever the cancer had taken from him, it had been given to me because he still needed it. So I was known as his right-hand man and my grandma's sugar boy. She even had the other older ladies that lived on our street calling me sugar boy. It was embarrassing while young, but as I got older, I didn't mind as much. From the time I was 6 years old, I was going down south with my granddad a few weeks every summer. We would hunt squirrels and rabbits, even though it wasn't hunting season. It was allowed as long as we stayed on our land and only took what we ate. Squirrel dumplings for breakfast and rabbit stew for dinner. When we had more than we could eat, or extra food of any kind, Grandpa would tell me, "Stay at the trailer," and he was going to go take the extra food to his forest buddy. As a kid, I thought he had a friend that actually lived in the woods, like a drinking buddy, because he wouldn't drink in front of the kids. He never did, but he would get on his side by side and head toward the trees. By 15 and after middle school, I was done with school, even though I was always on the honor roll. It just wasn't for me. So, Grandad, now 79 years old, had lost a step. But he was still sturdy, and even me at 15, I was full of piss and vinegar, and I didn't want to get on his bad side. He started letting me go on his fall hunting trips down south. We did some hunting, but mainly we made moonshine. He had a one-room cabin, an outhouse, a chicken coop, and a still that was deep in the woods. It was a good 20-minute ride on the side-by-side from the trailer. Once we got there, he loudly announced, "Hello, buddy. It's me. I've brought some goodies, and I have my right-hand man with me. He's a good one." He had brought some pheasants that had been in the deep freezer he hunted in Michigan, and 5 gallons of wine he made from the wild grapes that grew in our backyards in Detroit. Oh yeah, I forgot to add the salt. He would give them big 10-pound bags of table salt. I don't know what they'd do with it, but they do love salt. So we set out the gifts, checked the stills, made a fire, and went to work making his mash for the shine. He told me, "This is what my buddies love, the spent mash from the process of making the shine." There were chickens in the chicken coop. They looked healthy and had relatively clean water. I asked him, "Who feeds the chickens?" He said his buddies take care of them. So I was convinced at that point it was a man living in these woods. Because it was 2 other families living on the property. He leased a few acres to help with taxes and make sure the 30 or so acres that were cleared didn't get too overgrown while he was gone. Then the wine. I thought, yeah, he has a drinking buddy out here. Probably an old hermit that helps with the moonshine. We stayed in the cabin overnight. It had a small gas generator for light, a small refrigerator, a cot. We brought with us a small table, 2 chairs, a wash basin, and a wood-burning stove that we could cook on, warm water, and for heat if it got too cold. That first night, we heard 2 knocks on the side of the cabin. That scared the crap out of me. And Granddad said, "Oh, my buddy's here to get his package." I went for the door, and he told me sharply, "No, give him a minute. If he wants to talk, he'll let me know. He doesn't know you, and I don't want to surprise him. You'll meet him before we leave. We usually have a fish fry when the shine is done." Those next few days we spent in and around that cabin. I did have the feeling of being watched, but no fear at all. Like he said, all the used mash would be gone the next morning, and eggs from the chickens would be collected with about 6 left for us every morning. We even had a big piece of honeycomb, still capped, waiting for us in a bucket that had been set at the still. Granddad told me these were the best eggs and the best eating chickens you can get because of their diet. It was all natural. They eat a lot of bees, bee larvae, honeycomb, wild figs, and pawpaw fruit. So after the last batch of shine was taste tested and bottled, we loaded up and we headed back to the trailer and civilization. Then we got on the road east for over 2 hours to see the mullet fish man and traded him 3 half-gallon jugs of shine for what had to be 20 to 30 pounds of saltwater mullets, scaled and gutted, but heads still attached. We filled our coolers with ice and fish, stopped at a Food Lion and got a 2 gallons of peanut oil, some yellow cornmeal, salt and pepper, hot sauce, and 20 pounds of potatoes, and headed back to the property. I started taking stuff in the trailer, and Granddad said, "What are you doing, boy? We're going back to the cabin." Now I'm thinking, that spot's a secret, and that's too much food for him and I, and maybe 1 or 2 drunk hermits in the wood. But he had told me, besides him and his buddies, nobody knew about the still but my dead great uncle, which was his brother, and now me. And being in the woods, frying fish would attract the type of wildlife that I wasn't trying to fight for food. The father of one of the families living at one end of the property said the black bear and the feral hog populations were out of control to the point that it was open season on hogs year-round and nuisance tags were being given out for the black bears. But oddly enough, we had seen no signs of them at all in the woods. Grandad just half smiled and said, "Boy, I don't waste money or food." Once we got to the cabin site and lit the fire, I noticed he didn't announce his return. I asked why, and he said, "Oh, they'll smell it." Once that first batch of fish came out of the oil, my life changed forever. Out of my peripheral vision to my right, I saw what looked like a tree moving. It was so big. Grandad grabbed my arm because he saw that I was about to haul butt right out of there. He said, "That's my buddy, boy. Don't go making a fool out of me in front of him." We stood up, and this giant, hairy man put his huge hands on both of our shoulders. My granddad put his hand on top of his buddy's and said, "Hey, bud, just in time for dinner." And he motioned with his hand to his mouth. He pointed to me and said, "This is my grandson." I stuck my hand out, still unable to speak. Buddy grabbed my hand on the back side very gently, but I could still tell he could have crushed it without even trying. This was a man, more human than anything else, but covered in darkish black-brown hair. The skin tone, it was weathered like a native person. No cone head, but a more pronounced brow ridge, a flatter nose, and thinner lips, which was the only ape or monkey-like feature. There was no long neck, but the neck of a heavily muscled man. In height, he had to stand 7.5 to 8 feet tall. I'm 5 feet 10 inches, and I came to his lower chest, maybe. Hands and feet were bare. The face was hairless, except for the places a man would grow facial hair. Around the shoulders, upper arms, and lower legs, the hair seemed thicker or longer, just like the places a hairy man would have more hair. His shoulders, chest, arms, and legs were massive. He had to be at least 4 feet wide across the shoulders. If I had to guess a weight, I would say 450 to 500 pounds easy, all muscle though. There was no horrible smell, just the smell of someone who had been outside all day, body odor mixed with grass and earth. There was nothing foul or overwhelming. When I was finally able to speak, only thing I could say was, "Thank you for meeting me and allowing me in your home and helping my granddad." He once again patted us both on the shoulders and pointed to the direction he had come from. He made a sound and a click, and out walked 4 more of them, all smaller than him. 3 females and 1 male that was the smallest of them, but still only a few inches shorter than me. I looked at my granddad, and he was as normal as ever. I was scared, excited, in awe, and in disbelief all at the same time. They all walked in a line almost, and greeted my granddad with pats to the shoulder. And the oldest female, that had to be the mother of the big male, or mother to his mate or wife. She greeted him with a full hug like an embrace. Granddad later told me that her parents were the first that he had befriended, and he had known her all her life. Her mate had died, and the big male was her son-in-law. She was over 50, and that was very old for them. The old female had only a few visible teeth left, graying hair, and she walked kind of bent over. She also needed help standing once she had been sitting. The other two females were her daughter and granddaughter, who were mid-30s and mid to late teens in age, and the small boy was around 10 years old. He said the couple had another son that was a few years older than the girl, but had left the clan 2 years ago. He told me the males will leave around 15 years old to find a mate, but they will come back with the family if the father is old or has died, and the mother is too old to mate, and there is no male to protect the clan. The females are smaller, but just as sturdy. They have a complex language as their vocal range is far superior to ours, and they are great mimics as well. They copy the sounds of many animals, even birds. But we sat there, and we ate fried mullets and French fries with the Bigfoot family. My granddad, he sipped a little rhubarb shine, while I had mine with a water backer. I was only 15. And the Sasquatch family, they ate and drank some of the grape wine that was in the cabin, and also apple cider that we had brought from Michigan. We played a sort of charades-type game, and they laughed hard at me trying to climb a tree. I played some music from a portable CD player I had left in the cabin, and I tried to teach them to dance. The teen female was very shy, and she covered her face often and would whisper to her mother and grandmother. The young male, he was a typical 10-year-old, a ball of energy, always on the move. He was breaking sticks and checking out everything that was foreign to his normal world. They ate a lot of food, fish, both fried and raw, and they couldn't get enough of the French fries with extra salt. They took care of the old female, just like we would take care of a senior matriarch in our family. They brought her food. They mashed it up for her so she could eat it, since she had few teeth left. When nature called, the teen female escorted her away to do her business. These were truly human actions and emotions. We sat there for hours, well after sundown. Even with the language barrier, we seemed to be really enjoying each other's company. It wasn't like I was being entertained at a zoo or on a safari. It was like having a cookout with family from another country who spoke a foreign language. They seemed to understand me way more than I did them. When they finally all gave us our goodbye pats on our shoulders and heads, I even got a hug from the grandma, and the shy teen female with some encouragement from her mother. The young male, he gave a playful but hard slap on the back, then laughed as he ran away, which made everyone laugh. They took the leftover food and disappeared in the trees. My grandfather said, "See you tomorrow, bud. We need to tag a buck for the road." We put out the fire and headed back to the trailer. On the way back, Grandad said, "Now you see why we haven't had any bear or hogs messing around my still, and why my chickens could win prizes if I wanted." I said, "Your forest buddies are definitely nothing anybody or anything would want to trifle with." And he told me, "Now you know this is nothing you should be telling folks, especially your grandma. For one, they'll think you're loony, and that's okay. But if somebody actually believes you and comes looking, well, that's not going to be good for anybody." I woke up the next day, worse for the wear, to say the least. Being 15 and drinking moonshine with a family of Bigfoot, I thought maybe it had been a big dream. My granddad was already gone. His pickup was there, but the side-by-side was gone, and his orange hunting vest and rifle was gone, too. Well, guess I missed the hunt today. He came back later that afternoon with a nice buck on the back of the side-by-side. I said, "How'd you get that buck on the back of there by yourself?" He said, "I didn't," And he laughed. We took it to the barn and broke it down. Well, half of it. We put the other half back on the side-by-side and the whole hide. Then Grandad told me, "Take this to my buddy. This is his half." Now, I had never been to the still by myself, but if he was okay with it, I was too. I drove it in there. I laid it out on a log that we used for sitting when a fire was going. I called out, "Hey, buddy, I brought your meat. Thanks for helping my granddad." I got a few whistles in return. I grabbed a few things that were left in the cabin, and I made my way back. We made those trips for the next 6 years until my granddad passed in February 2002. The cancer had spread throughout his body and bones. He had broken his hip on a ladder, trying to clean gutters at church while 85 years old. He never complained about the pain, just said he had a little catch in his leg. After a month of limping around, I convinced him to go to the doctor, and we found out he had completely broken his hip. Once they got in there for surgery, they said the bones were like mush from the cancer, and they don't know how he was even walking around like that for over a month. Granddad passed away 2 months after. I promised him that I would go to the cabin, make a batch, and take down the still. I made a trip down in the summer to take some dogs down there. I had started breeding dogs, and I had worked out a deal with one of the land leases, where they would raise the young dogs for me for a bigger plot of the land. A few years prior, Big Buddy was so impressed with how I trained the dogs, I gave him a puppy to raise, a male Brazilian Mastiff, who grew to be a huge dog over the years, but was very well-mannered. Big Buddy would show off what tricks he had taught him and wait for my approval. It was very humbling that a being of such strength and majesty, who could take down a fully grown male black bear with his bare hands, he was looking to me for approval, like a toddler saying, "Look at me." When I returned that fall, I knew it may be a while before I was back, as it was very hard for me to make that trip without my granddad. So I brought individual gifts for the family along with the regular gifts for the females. I brought copper stone and crystal necklaces I had made for them, extra long, so they could slip them over their heads. For the young male, I brought a bowie knife and a sheath with a strap long enough to go over his shoulder and across his chest, and the same thing for the big buddy. But it was my granddad's knife and sheath, just fashioned with a long strap. Also, I brought a laminated obituary and an 8x10 photo of my granddad in a sturdy wooden frame with plexiglass instead of glass. They understood he was gone, and they all shed tears while trying to console me with shoulders and head pats. And there was this very comforting, like purring, that was like a warm blanket that I could feel more than hear. If I had to compare it to anything, I would say, it's like the feeling you get from a dose of morphine given through an IV while you're in the hospital. It's warm and euphoric. After I made the last batch of shine and started taking down the still, Big Buddy came and helped me load the heavy pots on the side-by-side. He called his family over to say goodbye. They were all sporting their gifts proudly. We exchanged our pats and hugs, and that was it. I left and didn't return until 8 years later. I didn't realize how much of a relief it is to get this out, since I've never really told anyone this besides my mom, who didn't believe me, and my wife, who is skeptical. When I did return in 2010, I went to clear out the trailer, since I was selling it and the land right around it, to one of the families that had been leasing some of the land at the west end of the property. I made my way back to the cabin site, and it had been taken over by nature. But the chickens, they were still there, and they were healthy, and there were more than I remembered. The coop had been mended with scraps of wood and natural fiber cords. The cot in the cabin was stained, as if something had given birth on it. I had called out when I got there, but I got no reply. But while in there, I got the familiar knocks, and then in the door was a huge male I did not recognize. That is, until I saw the Bowie knife and the sheath in his hand. It was the young male, all grown up and bigger than his father ever was. He greeted me with an embrace and a few head pats, but he seemed nervous and he kept looking around in all directions. Then I heard the talking coming from deeper in the woods, and he hurried back toward the trailer, almost escorting the side-by-side a half mile down the trail, which was slow going at that point, and he gave out loud grunts and growls along the way. I knew then things had changed, and I was no longer welcome that far in the forest. I still own that land and protect it as much as I can. A fence was built along the back of the cleared acres. No hunting, poaching, or trespassing signs are all along the property lines, and I donate to the local sheriff's department yearly to enforce it, too. Those times with my granddad and his buddies, I will always hold dear to me. I learned a lot about the outdoors, myself, and a culture that many others will never know. I consider myself blessed and lucky to have had these interactions, as so many have unsavory encounters. I don't think of myself as a Sasquatch expert, as there seems to be many different types of these beings. But I do consider myself a friend, or even a family member, of a clan of four. I can answer many questions about their diet, the way they live, and how they use the forest for all their needs. To this day, I would like to believe they're still maintaining those prized chickens in that secluded area of forest. Thanks, Nance, if you've made it this far. I hope I didn't ramble and bore you too much. Not a chance, Rusty. I hope to hear some version of this biopic because this isn't a story. I have lived this. I absolutely love your narrations, so I let it all out. Thank you. Signed, Rusty, grandson of a great man and the adopted cousin to Big Buddy Bigfoot and family. P.S. If you or the Sasquad would like to hear more stories about the time spent with the clan or have any questions, don't hesitate to reach out. I have theories on certain Sasquatch behaviors and the Appalachian feral people. Also, the proof is in the terminology used to describe these beings. More often than not, I see the word cannibal being used when it's said that they eat or hunt humans. Well, cannibal by definition is something that eats its own kind. So, if this is not a human species, why would the word cannibal or cannibalize be used so often? Just goes to show how they, the government, or the powers that be, they know exactly what Sasquatch, Bigfoot, Sabe, wood boogers, or skunk apes are, and that they're real. Thanks again to you and the Buckeye Bigfoot community for lending an ear and supportive shoulder. You can't imagine what it's like to live with the most amazing truth that you can fathom and not be able to tell anyone without actually sounding or looking like a crazed liar and thinking to yourself, was I really a few cards short of a deck? Signed, Rusty. Well, you know, folks, I sure hope that if I should ever run into a family of Sasquatch, that it's going to be like the ones in this encounter. I hope you enjoyed tonight's encounter. I found it fascinating. And Rusty, I don't think I need to tell you what the Sasquad will say. Of course we want to hear more encounters. Of course we do. Well, I think that's going to wrap it up for tonight. Thanks for stopping by. As always, I love having company. Anyway, Until we meet up again, always remember, absence of proof is not proof of absence. Thanks for listening, everyone. You hear that big cry, baby? You know, he thinks you don't like him enough to subscribe and hit the like button for the video. Now, I told him he's got you all wrong, and you really do like him. So go on, prove it to him. Hit the like and subscribe buttons if you haven't already, because let me tell you, I would really appreciate it. Because until you do that, there's going to be no peace for me with this big cry, baby. So thanks if you've hit those buttons.